Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Danger in the Past, an evening with Robert Forster. My name is Anthony Elliott. I'm the director of the Hawke Research Institute at the University of South Australia. And I'm going to be hosting tonight's discussion with Robert Forster, who's going to be joining us in a moment. One area of research strength for which the University of South Australia is justly celebrated is in the area of media and cultural studies. And it's within that area of media and cultural studies that we have many researchers working away, worrying away over the changing dynamics between celebrity, fandom and fame. And it's against that backdrop that the Institute has been particularly interested in and delighted now to be able to welcome tonight's speaker here. Amazingly, it's now over 30 years ago that the band that Robert Forster fronted, the Go-Betweens, released the single Cattle and Cain, a single that went on to be voted one of the top 30 Australian songs of all time. And across many albums and singles ranging from Spring Rain through to A Head Full of Steam, Streets of Your Town, through to Here Comes a City, the Go-Betweens, while never moving into the realm of mainstream commercial success, have been a band that, of course, established itself certainly within the Australian canon of pop music, but crucially also globally. Their songs were intensely provocative, poetic, and deeply personal songs. Throughout the 1990s, Robert Forster, after the Go-Betweens split up, went on, as many of you will know, to go and establish a very successful solo career, which he's done since the release of 1990's Danger in the Past through to 2008's The Evangelist. And along the way, he's garnered so many accolades and awards as a music critic, winning the Pascal Prize for Criticism in 2006, many other awards too in performance and writing and in other artistic ventures that he's undertaken. Robert Forster has a new album coming out next month called Songs to Play. And as I say, we're just absolutely delighted that he's visiting the Hawke Research Institute this week. And I'd now ask all of you to join with me in giving a very warm welcome to Robert Forster. Well, Robert, welcome to Adelaide. Welcome back to Adelaide.
I've been here a few times over the last couple of years, and I know my way around the inner city. I can leave my hotel, the Mayfair, and make my way to the market and go to my regular place where I have my porridge and coffee. And I know where I'm going.
Well, I've just been saying, we're absolutely delighted that you're here in Adelaide, although, as you and I discovered only yesterday, it turns out that there are many people that seem to think you might be performing tonight in San Francisco. Google Events has found the banquet room at the Fairmont Hotel in San Francisco, so there might be some Robert Forster Go-Between fans turning up.
Well, see, that could be the actor. There's a...
It was your picture.
Oh, really? Maybe it's the actor pretending to be me. But there's an actor, Robert Forster. He's best known for... He was in Jackie Brown. Tarantino brought him back. He's a sort of a 60s, 70s actor whose career got resurrected by Tarantino, which I'm hoping will happen to me as well. A Western where I'm shooting 100 people.
It's a matter of time, Robert. Mm. So what our plan is tonight is, and I'm sure there are probably smarter, cleverer ways of doing this, but I thought we would work through your body of work and the music that you've produced over the years, and Robert's kindly agreed to also play some songs for us. I don't want to start by going too far back, but there's one question I guess I do want to really start with here, because in terms of what I've read about you, it seems to me that, I mean, I understand that yours wasn't a musical childhood in any conventional sense. Is that, that's the case?
It was, that's true, which made my path to music very hard, difficult. It was, now that I look back on it, it was just one step, another step as I went through teenage years that could have quite easily have been diverted. I was in a family, just briefly, that no one played a musical instrument, and like a lot of Australian families, was sport obsessed, which I was as well. Like, it was just a almost like a disease that was in the family, and I was, I played cricket, I played golf, I played soccer, and my parents were sports fixated, and I felt very comfortable in that atmosphere. It was not like I was rebelling at 12 and or anything like that. I went through it all. But music in bits and pieces came to me, drew me.
In terms of finding a way in Brisbane to the University of Queensland in the 1970s, the 1970s finds you in the arts faculty, student of English Lit, getting the go-betweens, going, meeting Grant McLennan, and by about 1978, releasing your first single, Lee Remick and Karen. To an outsider, that all looked like it happened remarkably swiftly. One of the things that really intrigued me when reading about how the go-betweens came together, in interviews you've talked a lot about the sort of scripting of the band, the way the band was scripted. You talked about the Monkees, which was obviously a highly scripted, you know, TV band. And intriguingly, you talked about Mod Squad, fabulous Mod Squad. And given that for a long time in the early days, the go-betweens were you and Grant and Lindy Morrison, I mean, there's a sense in which I guess you were the musical Mod Squad.
We were.
Can you tell us a bit about how the go-betweens came together through this scripting, through this design?
Well, I mean, it's a very unconventional start for the go-betweens. the go-betweens weren't five guys playing the blues. It starts basically with me just writing songs, and I'd played with some musicians in Brisbane, and I realised that, you know, like punk had hit and I was following that, and we parted ways, and I just realised that really I had to teach my best friend. I could see that there was no musicians really in Brisbane that were on my wavelength, or that I'd spend years trying to find them, and time was going by, and I was writing songs. So I convinced my best friend, because we saw everything else in the same light. You know, we liked the same books, we liked the same films, we got on really well. Well, why shouldn't he be in the band? And I'd written songs like Lee Remick and Karen, as you said, that were quite musically simple. And so I said to Grant, I can teach you and to play bass. And he agreed to do that, probably thinking it would last a year. He was a keen film student, and he had his eye on going to NIDA, becoming a film director. So he had a spare year. And basically that was, the year became 35 years. But so the band, right from the word go, is very unusual in that there's no pub apprenticeships. There's no let's learn 20 Chuck Berry songs. There's no hanging around music stores. There's none of that. It's very much, we're in a house, I teach him to play the bass, I've got songs. And really Grant's idea of being in a band was what he'd seen, you know, the Monkees. He was a huge Monkees fan. And so for Grant, it was like, you hang around a house, you have adventures, you're never seen to load any equipment. You never go on tour. Davey's always sort of, girls are following Davey, and you know, and there's sort of where, you know, like really wacky adventures. And that looked great, you know. So we sort of, that's what we did. And so it was also, you know, like, because we were universities, pretentious university students, and Grant was, you know, like working at the university cinema, and you know, there was a lot of ideas that we got from university that went into the band. It was sort of highly, what you'd call now, conceptual, right from the word go. And it was as if, for him and I, you know, we could have been film directors, we could have been working in advertising together, you know, pitching ideas. We could have, but they were hard to do. You know, when you're 20, who's going to give you money to make a film? Who's going to allow you to go into a theatre space and muck around with actors? No one. But you could start a pop group. You know, that's, you could do that. And that's what we did.
So how did these two guys in this house, thinking that they're the monkeys in Brisbane, how do you get up and out of Brisbane, as you did via Melbourne, to get to London? A pathway, obviously, a musical pathway had been set up by Ed Cooper and Chris Bailey and the Saints, and, and they'd got out of Brisbane and they'd got to London. Were they a guide?
Totally. You know, like the Saints were it. You know, Grant and I saw that and it was like, well, there's the plan. You know, you record a classic single. You don't even bother going to Sydney or Melbourne. You get picked up by London EMI, I think it was. You get flown over there. You get put into a flat. You start making albums that go all around the world. Well, that was it, you know. And that's what Grant and I tried to do. It was like we had no desire to go down to Sydney or Melbourne and die on the pub circuit. Yeah. It just seemed like, again, wasting time, wasting effort. We went straight from our first show after Brisbane. The next show we did was in Glasgow. Like, that was our first show outside of Queensland. Outside of Queensland was Glasgow. No, our first show out of Queensland was Edinburgh, and then we played two shows in Glasgow with Orange Juice.
Yeah, it's quite amazing. The in terms of realizing that dream, and then after the release of the first album and the demos, mm-hmm. When you were in London then as a three-piece, when Lindy had joined mm-hmm. you, the album, the release of Before Hollywood, mm-hmm. was I mean, that was the wake-up call to many, that and certainly in terms of, you know, NME and the attention you were getting in the sort of from the indie press mm-hmm. and so on. But I guess it also established an interesting pathway which seemed to then continue for the Go-Betweens. Huge critical acclaim, limited commercial sales. Can you talk a little bit about that? What was that like when that first happened around Before Hollywood?
Well, some bands went over to the UK, like The Birthday Party, the Triffids were there, the Moodists were there. And it was a time when it was very hard to get a record company, an indie record company, to have enough money to pay a budget to make an album in Australia. And so really, we got to make Before Hollywood, which has Cattle and Cain on it, we were in Melbourne looking for a record company when Rough Trade in London said, come over and we'll pay for you to make an album. So we got asked to go over there. So we did. And so we were on independent record labels. So we were getting very good press. But especially in the 80s, if you wanted to sell records in the hundreds and thousands, you really had to be on Warner Brothers or Sony. You had to be on a major label. And we weren't. And so in a way that defined our career, the stretch of our career through the 80s. commercially, but artistically, we were, it's an even field, you know, like it's, artistically it's an even, it was as even as U2 or Bruce Springsteen, you know, like it's the same thing, we're all writing songs and we're recording them. It's just that U2 and Springsteen then have promotional budgets of $500,000 or, you know, can make four videos that each cost $300,000. We didn't have that. But on an artistic level, writing songs, going into the studio, it was all even. But as soon as it left the studio, there was imbalances which resulted in them selling more records. But that's just the way that it was.
Mm, mm. Whether it was a stab at a more commercial direction, I mean, an album that I think is often unfairly sometimes dismissed by some critics as not sitting as evenly in the rest of the go-betweens catalogue was, it's one of my favourite albums, is Spring Hill Fair.
Mm-hmm.
And then when that was released, there were comments from, I gather, different band members that weren't as happy with it. It seemed to, was that a time of, I mean, was that part of the strategy? Were you trying to go in a more commercial direction with that album?
Well, it was hard because in a way we were an underground band, but then we had someone like Grant who was just a fantastic pop writer. And so there was always a little bit of a tension because to an extent brought through Grant's songs, but then you look at the album after that, Liberty Bell, I write the singles. I wrote Spring Rain. Yeah. I wrote Head Full of Steam, which confused the hell out of record companies because what they wanted, even independent record companies, is they want, you know, they want, you're the front guy, you're the guitar player, you're the bass player, you're the drummer, all the interviews are done with the lead singer, he's on the edge of the stage, and it's a sort of strategy that works, you know, like that's easy for a record company. We confused people by having, for a start, by having two singer-songwriters who could both write A-sides. And really, you know, how many other examples of that are there? I mean, there's obviously the Beatles, you know, perhaps XTC, you know, but it's a hard sell. And so I think that was always a push and pull as well through the 80s. But then Grant wrote Bachelor Kisses, which is from the album that you're talking about. And one other factor was that we're in London. And London, especially in the 80s, was pop central. It was like the whole thing was just geared to the radio and BBC. And it was Culture Club, it was Wham, it was the Human League, it was the Thompson Twins. And all the, you know, punk bands and post-punk bands were suddenly trying to be them. I mean, the Human League were a punk band, electronic punk band at one stage. So, you know, new pop came in, and so all the people that used to be punk suddenly thought they were pop stars. And so it was very much a pop time, and for us as well. So, you know, like we've got a pop writer in the band who's just written Bachelor Kisses. So do you sabotage that, or do you try and follow it? And this is all the pushing and pulling that went on that made it, especially for that album, like a difficult time. You're not sure of the game you're playing.
Yeah, it's an album that I think has weathered the years really well.
Sorry to interrupt. The thing with the Go-Betweens was, right at the start, we weren't Sonic Youth. We weren't Einstürzende Neubauten. We weren't an obvious noise, no chance of the top 40. You're in the underground, that's where you are, and that's where the band's happy. We weren't that, unfortunately, or fortunately. We were a pop band that was different. And so that's where the difficulties, you know, placing us began.
So when you were writing those singles, Spring Rain, Head Full of Steam,
mm-hmm.
out of Liberty Bell, into Tallulah,
mm-hmm.
the trio is joined by Robert Vickers mm-hmm. and then Amanda Brown. I think for many people there's probably a sense that seemed a very golden period.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed a really crucial period mm-hmm. for the Go-Betweens. Just upon reflection, when you look at it, did with Amanda Brown joining and the sound being augmented with her considerable range and so on, did that then influence, I mean, trying to get a sense of what you were all aiming at in the late 80s? Because it's
I mean, we were the most beautiful band in the world. We could walk on stage. We didn't really have to play. We could just stand on stage and stare at people, and that was enough. But I mean, it's a different thing. Like Amanda brought something to the band, is that she was a lot younger, so she brought a certain naivety and enthusiasm. Like we were starting to get a little bit jaded by then, and so she was a good, besides everything else she brought to the band in terms of as a multi-instrumentalist, she brought like a really good spirit into the band. Visually, as I said, we were amazing. But the same sort of things were still going on about what type of group we were. I mean, I was very happy with a lot of what we were doing. But this was very much the 80s. It was very hard for a commercial rock band to make authentic music. Yeah. Was like... Look at the Triffids, like they virtually imploded. Like they made, Born Sandy Devotional, and then they got caught up in it too. Yeah. And you'd think, God, they're from Perth. They were really, like knowing them, they were a very tight band. They're really good friends, and they got caught up in the whole London mind games of producers and money and, and if a band as tough as that can, fall under it. It was hard. It's easier now because the game's changed, but then it was like huge budgets and London is very, very much, especially in the 80s when I was in, I think it's just from the 60s and the 70s and the 80s, a pop town, just relentless.
Well, we're going to come to how things have changed and get your views on that a bit later. 7:25, it says here, musical interlude. That's you, and you can either stare at the audience or play. Robert Forster.
Okay, I'll play. Come and have a look beside me, a fine line of tears part company. That's her handwriting, that's the way she writes. From the first letter that I got to this, a bill of rights part company. What will I miss? I'll miss her cruelty, her unfaithfulness, her fun, her love, her kiss. Part company. That's her handwriting, that's the way she writes. Like mud in the September rain, it comes back to me. Company made a man disappear. I cut my sway, then I spread my fear. Before we met, I hadn't wiped my feet, seen myself naked, or part company. I said it before, do I have to say it again? A fine line
cheer back on me. That's her handwriting. That's the way she writes. From her first words to this, our last night. Part. Yeah, part. Company made the men disappear. I cut my swathe and I spread my fear.
Dove's Court Park Company.
Thank you, Robert. I want to, if I can, just stick for one moment longer with that kind of period that you were describing before the song, because it's, and this is partly based on something that you and I were talking about yesterday in a different environment, in terms of if you think of that particular period out of now, out of Tallulah, going into the making of 16 Lovers Lane, you made the comment yesterday that it was a period where you almost lost yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really intrigued by that because I was thinking in terms of, and this is partly comes out of some of the celebrity studies literature, that there's a, in terms of where the go-betweens were going with 16 Lovers Lane, the huge amount of kind of attention that was getting, you were supporting REM around the world.
Mm-hmm.
Your appearance at that time was very interesting when out of Tallulah, when you had the longer hair, the Blake Carrington look of the steel grey hair and the so on and so forth. And I was really struck when you said that you almost lost yourself at that point, because it was a point where I think many fans were connecting to you, were finding you.
Mm.
So there's a kind of exquisite irony in that from one angle.
Yeah,
and wonder what you think of that.
I've been in London for 5 years, and towards the end of it, I was in my late 20s, which I think is anyone's physical peak, and I was my head was filled with romantic ideas. I was extreme. I loved extremes in art. I was unraveling to an extent. I was trying to make the band break through almost by the sheer force of my personality. I was a long way from home. I had there was no rhythm or rhyme to my life. There was no one of responsibility or wisdom anywhere near me. I was careering around town. I meet people later in the 90s who'd say that they saw me or met me at that time, and I asked them what was I like, and they start laughing. Or just smirk and just shake their head. It was that sort of time, you know. Like I think a lot of people go through it. I think there's a time in everyone's life where you're the furthest away from what you actually are, and normally it happens in your 20s. It can happen in your late teens, and you look back, and you can be in your mid 50s, and think, God, I used to smoke cigarettes. You know, I used to. Drink, you know, half a bottle of vodka in one go. I used to, you know, if someone, you know, was having cocaine, I'd take it. You know, like I'd chase women I didn't know. You know, like I'd wake up in the gutter. You know, like it's not only me. It happens to people. You know, lawyers look back on their lives. You know, people that are COs have lived these sort of things. But that was the time. That was a particular time. Like I sort of. Yeah. As further out as I ever went. If you look at footage of me, you know, with the grey hair, I was wearing dresses on stage. I was wearing dresses off stage. I was. I'll tell you what it is. I look like my songs. That's what it was. And so, if you're writing songs like "Spirit of a Vampire," or "The House That Jack Kerouac Built," or "When People Are Dead," that's what you're going to look like.
Yeah, that makes a great deal of sense to me. It does. In terms of you wrote, then this now gets to the when the go-betweens broke up. Mm-hmm. You've written of you commented on that, and you said, I just want to read this to get it right. You said we'd written 6 lauded albums, but the band was broke. Mm-hmm. I mean, apart from the fact that. That must have been terribly difficult to deal with. How difficult then was it to decide to break up the band?
Breaking up the band was a difficult decision. Grant and I did it, which confused people later on because as soon as I did an album, my next album was Danger in the Past, and I'd go out and I was doing interviews and people, or every journalist was going, so you and Grant had a big breakup and you break up the band and, you know, you mustn't talk to each other and, you know, you must hate each other. And we were like, I was like, no, we stopped the band together. So there was a misconception there. It was, you know, why a band breaks up after being together for 11 years, there's a lot of reasons. Hmm. A band that breaks up after 11, 15, 20 years doesn't break up for one reason. A band that's been together for 6 months can break up for one reason, but not a band that's been together for over 10. And so there was a number of reasons for the go-betweens breaking up. Two of them, you know, like we were about to start an album, to record an album in early 1990, which would have been our 7th album in 9 years. Mm. Imagine what that's like. And you're in debt. And you've just made your most commercial album and it's just throwing you even more in debt. And you just sort of go, you have to start asking questions. You know, you have to start to reflect on where you are.
And so you did, and that involved moving to live in Germany.
Yep.
And you went and lived in Bavaria.
Mm-hmm.
And in time recorded Danger in the Past with mm-hmm. Mick Harvey producing the album, and that mm-hmm. seemed there was part of it was continuous with the Go-Betweens, but it was also a kind of quieter departure. It was clearly a very important album.
Yes.
How did you go about figuring out how you were going to do it alone?
Oh, that was easy. The album was recorded in Hansa Studio in Berlin, and it's where it's most famous because Bowie did Low and Heroes there, and Iggy Pop did his 2 albums there. Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds had done Your Funeral, My Trial there. And after I was there, you two came in and did, what's the album? Achtung Baby. So it was a very, very famous studio. And the Go-Betweens toured in Berlin. I'll try and keep this short. And we toured Berlin in 1997, and I phoned up Hansa and asked if I could come down and have a look, and I did. And so I'd seen the studio, and when I went down there, I was thinking that maybe the Go-Betweens would record there. But then, you know, 2.5 years later, the band had broken up, and I'm living down in Bavaria, mm-hmm. and Mick Harvey is living in Berlin, and I'd known Mick since the birthday party. You know, we played a lot of shows with the birthday party, so I'd known Mick for 10 years. And so it's like, I just phoned up Mick and said, I want to make a solo album. And he said, we could do it in Hansa. And I went, yeah. He just went, well, we'll get Thomas on drums and I can play bass. And have you got the songs? I said, yeah. And so it just, it happened in 12 days. It's an album I'm very, very proud of.
Hmm. Following that album and over the next few years, there were quite a few albums. I wouldn't say quite quickly, but they were coming out months to 2 years.
Yeah, yeah.
Calling from a Country Phone, 1993. I Had a New York Girlfriend. And then in 1996, with Warm Nights and the track that we saw earlier, Crying Love, you worked with Edwin Collins, produced that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That gets us to about halfway through the 90s. Mm. It seems like you packed a lot in.
Yeah.
In that first half of the 90s.
Yes, I did.
And did it seem like that?
It did. I was still sort of chasing something. I was still... I still was signed to Beggar's Banquet, who'd put out the last three Go-Betweens albums. And I was still... I was in my 30s. My wife and I were married. We had no children. So the coast was clear. I could devote to putting out records and touring. And I did that until... 96, as you say, and then I stopped. And my wife and I moved from Brisbane back to Germany, and I was in a period very similar to the one I was in 2008 after The Evangelist, where I went, I'm going to stop. I'm just going to write 10 songs, and I sort of sat back. I was ready to stop. I was coming up to 40. We were thinking of having children, and I thought... I'm not a star, I'm 40, maybe it's time to just concentrate on songwriting and just let it go.
Mm-hmm. And that wasn't in any way connected, because the other key thing that happened around that period in 95, 96 is records are no longer being made, there's the switch to CDs and I mean the industry's going through quite a big change, but it wasn't connected to that.
No. I would say the record industry started to change and really started to reorganize and plummet, I'd say around 2000. If you look at a career like, say, a band like Powderfinger, they were selling records in bulk really until about 2005, 2006. And I think the industry was still going strong up until then. So no, that didn't happen.
Okay, all right. We've done these 1990s quite quickly and we're coming up now to another music interlude. But just before we do that, can I ask you, how do you write songs? And by that I mean, you know, there's the rather romantic notion of the artist being struck by the idea and you're just consumed with passion and you've got to, you know, write it down and record it. Then there's the other kind of more workman-like model. To my mind, that's been really well encapsulated with someone like Nick Cave, who's commented that, you know, where he lives in Hove, that in the morning he leaves the house and walks to his office and starts at 9 o'clock and writes all day long, and when it gets to 5 o'clock, he heads home. What's it like for you? How do you approach it?
Well, The Nick Cave model that you're talking about is what I follow in terms of my writing. You know, when I was writing for the Monthly, and I'm currently writing a book, and that's what I've been doing for the last, since about 2005. When for songwriting, I don't have to be in the shed at 9 o'clock, but I write in the morning. It's what we're talking about at the start. I wouldn't say I'm an innate musical person. Music, you know, I love music and I can play it and do it, but I'm not someone who can fashion a song or someone who can write really good sort of, you know, like write me a, you know, like a soul pastiche or write that sort of. I can only write Robert Forster songs, and I try all the time. And really, I only write about two or three songs a year if I'm lucky, even though I'm trying every day when I'm really going. And that's just the way that I've been really since the early 80s. It just explodes in suddenly 6 months, I think it's over. The amount of times I've thought, I'm trying all the time. You know, I'm not Paul Simon, I'm not Paul Weller, I'm not Tim Rogers. You know, I'm not someone who can, 10 songs by 3 months, Yeah, okay, they could all do it. And, a lot of what they'd do would be pretty good, But I'd turn up and I'd sort of go, I've got nothing. I've tried all the time, I've got nothing. And then suddenly I'll write something, and a lot of my songs, like, say, Park Company, it's all just one thing I write in one go. I'll often do that. It's just like one chord change or one riff, and I'll go, that's it. If you know my songs, they're mainly built on one really good bit with other bits added. I'm not Paul McCartney or Lennon or obviously Burt Bacharach or someone like that who's, like shifting and going like that,
Robert, could we hear another Robert Forster song?
Yeah.
This is a song from the album that we're talking about, from Warm Nights from 1996. This is something that I can't do. Pick up the rhythm I get from you. Some of it's old and some of it is new. Always known and never followed it through. Surprised, I'll be there. I can do. Don't be surprised and don't be scared. I can do, 'cause this is something that I can do. Pick up the rhythm I get from you. I can do, yeah. Reminds me of Africa, though I've never been. I can do. Her ice water eyes and her costume of sand. I can do, 'cause this is something that I can do. Pick up the rhythm that I get from you.
That song's a homage, in a way, to one of my favourite bands of all time, Creedence Clearwater Revival.
And I think many people probably think there's a fair bit of credence in throughout Spring Rain, One to One.
Yeah. I grew up with them. I was like 11 or 12, and like no record player in the house or anything. But I used to listen to a lot to AM radio. And if you were listening to AM radio in the late 60s, you know, like I was 10, 11, 12, Creedence were there. And I love Fogerty's voice. And Fogerty's voice came over and just slayed me. You know, like, it was a big voice to be on pop radio because everyone was very sort of almost twee in comparison. And, you know, I didn't really know it at the time, but, you know, like, the band was so funky. You know, Doug Clifford on drums, you know, Stu Cook on bass. Very funky band. You know, and like, and all the songs, you know, like 2.5 minutes, and just Fogerty was on fire as a songwriter, and all those singles. It's also something to do with Brisbane. Like, they're almost like a, there's a sweaty, sort of swampy feeling to Creedence that sort of goes with Brisbane. You know, they could almost be a Brisbane band, you know.
We're jumping ahead into you as a music critic here, but I just figure you might have a theory about this. Why did someone, I could never work this out, someone as clearly talented as John Fogerty, seemed to be able to effortlessly write all these great hits, and then kind of after Creedence it all stopped?
That's one of the great mysteries that I've never been able to solve. I wonder about that at least once a week. I don't know. It's like, there's so many examples. Like, for me, a great songwriter was John Sebastian from Love and Spoonful. He wrote an amazing amount of songs. He wrote 15 great songs from 1965 to the middle of 1967, and then it stops. You look at John Phillips, you know, from Mamas and Papas, an amazing songwriter. Wrote, you know, like 15, 20 great songs between 1965 and about 1969, stops. You know, and you just go, and Fogerty is another classic example. You just go, well, what happened? You know, it's like, my only thing is that they plug into something within their own songwriting and the time, and it just fires for about 2 or 3 years, and then it just goes out. It's just, and they can, you know, Fogerty can still write a good song, you know, occasionally, but it just, I often wonder, it amazes me. I think about it a lot too.
David Byrne's another one.
Yeah, David Byrne. You know, I don't know. It's something where you're in the zone. I know this sounds very sort of straightforward, but and everything's just working. And I think part of it is you're not double thinking yourself. It's all just sort of coming out. You're not thinking too hard. Look at Ray Davies. Yeah. You know. Look what he wrote for the Kinks. Look at Pete Townsend. I mean, but Townsend and Ray Davies, well, I mean, look at Jagger and Richards. They haven't written a song in 30 years. But for a time, those guys were writing for 10 or 15 years. You know, like Ray Davies wrote well. Pete Townsend wrote well. McCartney wrote well for a long time, longer than this 2 or 3 year period.
That was an interesting digression. Robert, we're up to the 2000s when something happened in the 2000s, right in 2000, which many fans had long wanted but probably thought was never going to happen, which was that the Go-Betweens got back together. Last year here at the Hawke, we had Lloyd Cole, a UK singer-songwriter. He was visiting with us for a period, much like yourself this year, and he took the credit for getting the Go-Betweens back together. When he said that he'd invited Ewan Grant to join him on his tour, and that he was very, very happy to take the credit for that. How did the Go-Betweens get back together?
Grant asked me. Simple as that. We're on tour in 1999 promoting a album called Bella Vista Terrace. The Go-Betweens didn't have a best of CD. And Beggars Banquet, our record label that owned the rights to it, just went, look, we need to put out a single Go-Betweens best of. And my manager phoned me and said that they were going to do this. And what do you want to do? And I said, oh, well, why don't Grant and I just sort of go out and just go around the world quickly, tour, play clubs, and just do interviews and just do 6-week blitz thing. And a couple of days into it, in Australia, Grant just said, I think we should get the band back together, which took me by surprise. You know, like, it was, we'd only just started the tour. And I'd had to ask him twice to start the band. And so there was a sort of a closing of a circle. And I said yes.
You went on then to record The Friends of Rachel Worth. An unusual album in the sense that some critics claim straight away that the band had reformed and arguably then had produced a better album than when the band was originally together. That's what some said.
All right.
Then there was follow-up albums, Bright Yellow, Bright Orange, Oceans Apart, which you got on a major award in Australia. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, in 2006, Grant tragically died. Mm-hmm. You've written about that very movingly elsewhere, and tonight's not the night to go into that. But what I'm wondering is when that happened, how did you work out what you were going to then, in time, work out what you were going to do from there?
I didn't really know. I knew two things. First of all, we were working on the next album when Grant died, and he'd played me about five songs, which I thought were the best five songs he'd played me since 16 Lovers Lane, you know. But Grant and I never recorded anything. We never demoed. Grant and I have no home recording gear. We sort of right until the end, it was like, you know, like Woody Guthrie and Pete Seeger back in 1940 or something. You know, it was just like two people in a room with acoustic guitars. That's all it was. No recording gear, no one doing demos, no one making computer things and sending it to the other. I drove over to his place, the guitars would come out, drink coffee, talk, start playing. So I knew these five songs that no one else knew, and I thought they were fantastic. And so I wanted to work with some of those songs because I remembered them. You know, I saw him play them, and I had guitar bits. And if I didn't do anything with those songs, they would just disappear forever. And so I picked three that I thought were great. So that was the start of The Evangelist, which was an album I made a year and a half later. At the same time, in 2005, which was a godsend in a number of ways, I'd started writing for The Monthly. Mm-hmm. So I had this other thing outside of music. I already had a couple of songs for this next album. Grant had already had three that I sort of wrote lyrics for. So there was sort of, the writing was going, and I already had, I know this is going to, you know, like when he passed, you know, like the, we were on the way to another album. Mm. And so my paths were fairly clear. You know, although I was shattered and shocked that he died, a record was underway and I was working as a music critic, which helped.
And that turn to criticism saw you win the Pascal Prize for Criticism. And again, if I can quote, the judges said on that you write, and I quote, about popular music with an authority and grace which would be rare in any area of criticism. With many of your essays being collected and then published as a book, The 10 Rules of Rock and Roll. I'm not going to give too many of these rules away for people here that haven't bought the book. You should go and buy the book. But just a couple of, to give you a flavour of maybe just two of these rules. Great bands tend to look alike. The band with the most tattoos has the worst songs. And the one that I really want to ask you about, because I think you've nailed it. I think it's absolutely right. The second last song on every album is the weakest. Mm. But what I wanted to ask you with that, I'm guessing you're exempting your own work, because on my count that would take out the Clark Sisters, I'm All Right, Going Blind, Something for Myself, many others. So you're not in that company.
No, but I've sequenced albums, and there's a formula that even now everyone sort of pretty much follows with sequencing a record. And not, you know, like say on 10-track album, song 9 is generally, you've got a strong song on side 2, or, you know, like song 8, you've got a big song. You, every band goes out with what they think is a big song or a nice sort of, you know, very moving ballad, you know, or a big rock song or something. So there's a gap there. And a lot of, when you're looking at the songs, a band doesn't even consciously do it, but they slip in. That's the place to slip in the weakest song. It just automatically happens.
Okay, so we're going to come back after the next song and belatedly get to the two tens. So, Robert Forster, another song. Okay. Thank you.
This is a song. I hope I can play it with the light on my guitar. This is a song I sometimes introduce, especially in Brisbane. I dedicate it to a surfer by the name of Michael Peterson, who was a great underground hero in Brisbane and Australian surfing in the 70s. And I guess I dedicate it today to Mick Fanning, another hero. We used to get our kicks reading surfing magazines. Some good-looking people wearing Lee Cooper jeans. They're breaking on the headland, they're breaking on the shore. When you're living in Hawaii, they're breaking at your door. To wet our fingers on surfing magazines. Gonna throw school and follow those scenes. Gonna get a combi and go from beach to beach. Be the kind of people the authorities can't reach. Get our kicks reading surfing magazines. Wake up in the morning and the waves are clean. Standing on the headland, taking in the scene. Just like they do it. They do it. They do it. Surfing magazines, da da da, da da. Surfing magazines, da da da, da da. Surfing magazines, ba da da, da da. Surfing magazines, da da da, da da. Surfing magazines, yeah. Surfing magazines. Surfing magazines. And Gary, Bell Speech Dial. Surfing magazines. Byron, why me,
Thanks very much, Robert. It brings us now finally and gets us into the 210s and the, for anyone looking at what you're doing, the obvious and increasing diversification of your career, not only in terms of your work as a musician, you've been producing the John Steele Singers, other bands in Brisbane, forays now into performing as an actor. You already mentioned the work for the monthly and working on this book, and we'll get to hopefully some of these, but what I wanted to ask you is how much of this was planned to kind of do all this, or has some of it just been serendipity and good fortune?
I think the starting off point was when I started to work for the monthly and people could see that I did something else, because up until then I was 48 when I started to write for the monthly in 2005. And it was sort of, I guess you're in a bag and I guess you're doing something, and then suddenly I did this and it just opened up. I just started to go sideways. It was like, you know, I was on that branch and then suddenly there was a thick branch, you know, and then suddenly it went off over there, and then that grows for about a meter, and then it starts, that goes off, and then that goes off. It's, you know, I think it's like in anything, if people find you can do other things, it's like if you're a builder and, you know, suddenly you can do a little bit of plumbing and people go, oh, okay, well, do that, and then you're doing plumbing, and then they find out you can, you know, landscape a bit, and so suddenly you're doing that. You know, it just sort of, it just goes, and I was lucky enough. It was great luck that I got asked to write for the monthly, because I was not an obvious choice, because they jumped over every rock critic in the country, you know, wanted that job. And Christian Ryan, the editor, asked me first. And he took a big gamble, and I found out that I could do it. I didn't even know that I could, but I did. So that was the start of it.
Yeah. It's been great that you've, you know, in some interviews in media that you've talked, I think, very honestly about the ways you've sort of branched out, and you've talked about often about branching out, because certainly for students at the university now, there's a sense in which, you know, in the new economy, that there's a kind of requirement to be able to, against a backdrop of lifelong learning, of to be able to be adaptable, to be flexible, and to be kind of, to keep trying to kind of reinvent different aspects of what it is you can do. That brings me to ask you what you make of, in our age of social media, of what's happening to music and the music industry. Last year, some colleagues at the Hawke, we were trying to calculate around the kind of Spotify model. I think we worked out that for every 1,000 downloads, an artist today is likely to get about 7 cents. Clearly, it's from one angle a sort of self-defeating economic model. What's your view about where that leaves musicians today and the prospects for starting off?
Well, it's very hard. The income for a musician has been completely cut away, because they're no longer getting royalties. You know, like I thought I'd be getting, you know, record royalties for 16 Lovers Lane for Liberty Bell for the rest of my life. You know, like, you know, just the way that Paul McCartney expected it from Revolver, or Mick Jagger did from, you know, Exile on Main Street. You know, it just sort of, but that, with music being free on the internet and record sales virtually drying up, a lot of pension schemes, a lot of the income dried up for musicians. I find I work with musicians through producing in Brisbane, and so I know quite a lot of musicians in their 20s and early 30s, and they go into a whole, they approach it in a whole different way. They now all have part-time jobs or full-time jobs, and so they can be being played on Triple J, they can be touring, they can be going overseas and doing tours in America, and they come back and the next day they're doing 8 hours of childcare. You know, it's that whole thing of, wow, we've been signed, everyone dropped their jobs, we're going to sit around the house, we're going to write songs, that's all gone. You know, every musician knows that that no longer exists. You've got to, it's all part-time work, and music becomes your great hobby. That's the way it is.
This hasn't deterred you. The 18th of September is an important date. It sees the release of your new album, Songs to Play. Can you tell us about the album?
It's my first album in 7 years, and to me it's a new chapter. To me it's the next thing I'm doing. After The Evangelist, which was in a very much recorded in the same studio with the same producer and the same musicians that Oceans Apart, the last Go-Betweens album was, and had three Grant songs on it, I knew then, I'll never make an album like this again under these circumstances, and that when I went out on tour, I just started to have these new songs, new feelings, and I knew that I was into, if you like, to be, you know, like, very direct, you'd have to say it's act four, you know, like there was Go-Betweens, you know, and then there was that period of solid years through the 90s, the Go-Betweens restart, this is the fourth act. And I knew that, and I wanted to mark it by time. I didn't want to put out an album for 5 years. And the 5 years became seven, because I just wanted time to go by. I thought the best way to tell everyone in the whole world that was interested that I'm embarking on a new feeling, a new time, a new chapter, was to just let time go by. And that's what I did. And so the record that I've made now is just quickly, it's recorded in Brisbane, it's recorded completely on analog, I didn't want to do digital, it's recorded on a mountain above, just like the Adelaide Hills here, you know, like just up above Brisbane. I didn't want to do digital, I have a band playing in a studio and not come in and everyone just sort of goes around the screen and is looking at that. I didn't want that. You went out, you played, and you sat there, and you were just listening to playback. You know, just looking at the ceiling. And then go, no, that's not right, let's go back. That's what I wanted to do. My wife's on the record. There's a lot of new things. You know, like my wife and I played music in the kitchen in our house for 25 years, and we just never the right moment. So she's on the album. My son's on the album. He's 17. And the two main musicians, you'd have to say, are Scott Bromley and Luke McDonald, who are from a band called the John Steele Singers, who are incredibly talented multi-instrumentalists from Brisbane. And so it's a whole new cast in a whole new environment, and I'm very happy with the album. It's the first record I've ever made in my life where at the end of it I had no idea how it's going to go. You know, we all made it and we're really happy with it. It's really unique, it's really beautiful, the song's great, but I don't know how it fits into any landscape, I don't know how anyone's going to take it, and that was just almost a wonderful feeling. It feels very liberating, it's a very liberating record.
Well, we wish you well with it, Robert.
Thank you.
I don't know how to ask this next question, but let me take a crack at it. The promotional video that's gone with the Songs to Play has colleagues, musicians and family talking about the making of the album, talking about you. In the video there's a comment where someone's reflecting on what are you like, and the comment is, well, you know, he's all right but he can be a bit serious. There's another comment that's made where it said, he's difficult. I've just spent the last meeting you yesterday. I don't find you difficult at all. But what I'm trying to get at is, and it took me back to a comment in some of the literature where Lindy Morrison had remarked that and you were sharing a house in Melbourne, that when people came over, that when people came over, you would go out. So, you know, are you an introvert? How difficult has the career that you chose to go into, how difficult that has that been? Because I think when people see you on stage, and for those that have seen you perform, you certainly can be a real showman, but I'm curious about that.
That's a very good question. I think there's a basic assumption that everyone, the way they are on stage, they are the way off, which is completely false. Like most of the most outgoing performers I know on stage are fairly quiet off stage, and it can be the exact the opposite way. I'm not a particularly social person. I've got work to do, and we're talking about, you know, the hard economic times. You know, like over the last, it's come very close. You know, like in my over the last 10 years of completely falling apart, and you know, us having to sell our house, and you know, there's very little money in music, and it's been tough for me and my family. So I have to work hard at home to keep the wheels going. Not that I don't like doing that. I do. But I'll let you in on a secret. No one knows this. This documentary that you're talking about, this 8.5 minute documentary where the woman says, you know, what's he like? He's difficult. I scripted the whole thing. So everything that everyone says in that documentary, I wrote. And so I took great joy and when they were being filmed, because no one knows this. It'll go out in social media now. But I wrote everything that everyone said. So I'm a control freak, but no, I'm not. I'm not a particularly, I'm shy, I think, as well, which probably, I'm happy with the way that I am in terms of relation with the way I am on stage and off stage. I find it very, but I disappoint some people, and there's a song off the on the new album. The first track is called "Learn to Burn," and there's a lyric in one of the verses: "I'll disappoint you, I'll let you down," and there's some people that I do let down, because perhaps I'm not as, you know, wild and as outgoing as I appear to be, perhaps. Yeah. This is getting into very, very heavy.
It is.
Self-analysis.
The time is now against us. So,
okay.
So, but I do want to just, in terms of keeping the wheels going, just note, because this, I think, seems to me fantastic, that you're about to head off on a tour for this new album.
Yeah.
A tour throughout Australia, but also a tour that it will take you next month to Dublin, to the National Concert Hall, where you're acting, joining in what's called a provocation on Yeats.
Yeah.
And then a tour that's taking in parts of the UK, Germany, Austria, Switzerland. Mm-hmm. So you'll be very busy.
I'm really looking forward to it. I haven't toured, you know, it's like what I was saying about the album. I didn't know how it was going to be received or how it's going to go, but I'm very excited about it. It's the same with playing live. I haven't done a tour in 8 years. Imagine what that's like for a musician, you know.
Yeah.
I really look forward to playing night after night and going out. The records, this is the type of record where I can play a lot of the songs live. It feels like that kind of record.
Yeah. Well, Robert, we wish you great success with this album. We hope that the tour goes really well for you, and I think I've probably got the confidence of the room with me in saying that we also hope that it's not 7 years until the next album. But Robert Forster, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Anthony. Thank you very much. Thank you for listening to Anthony and I talk. And I want to thank Anthony for inviting me here to Adelaide. And I've very much enjoyed his questions and his angle on what I do. And so it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you. And I'd like to...
I'd like to play you a song from my new album. It's called Let Me Imagine You. There was silence, things we didn't know. There was romance, where I couldn't go. Please don't tell me, let me dream and guess. Please don't tell me, let me dream and guess. I missed the ballet you directed. Was it a big success? Let my imagination move those figures around my head. You in Paris, deep in trouble, yes. Is the memoir finished? Let me dream and guess. I heard you went shopping and bought such beautiful things. Let me get my calculator and add up the cost of all those things. Oh my. Please don't Twitter. Let me imagine you. I find it sweeter. Let me imagine you. Let me imagine you. Let me imagine you. Let me imagine you. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.